After taking on the fifth-ranked team in the nation last weekend and taking them to the absolute limit, the UMass Boston women's hockey team will spend their Thanksgiving weekend tucking into some lighter fare. It's time for the Codfish Bowl Tournament. Live from the Edward T. Berry Ice Rink in Boston, Massachusetts, I'm Milton Posner, and you're watching UMass Boston Hockey on the Beacon's Broadcasting Network. This is the return of the Codfish Bowl after a year off. Tournament with a long and rich history. We will get into it later. On the women's side, this is the 14th annual Codfish Bowl. UMass Boston took one title. They've been playing in this tournament continuously since its founding in 2008. Just one title despite 26 games. That's more than twice as many as any other school. They are looking to expand the resume here. This is the first ever matchup played between these two teams. Trine University's a little bit outside of their area here. They came the furthest of the four teams. It's going to be UMass Boston, Trine, Stevenson, and Bowdoin playing in this one. The Beacons, Thunder, Mustangs, and Polar Bears, respectively. Trine's coming all the way from Angola, Indiana. It's about an 800-mile drive over about half a day for the women of Trine University, for the Thunder. They have come to UMass Boston to take on the Beacons in the opening game of the Codfish Bowl. The second game, which is going to take place right after this one, Stevenson University against Bowdoin College. The losers will face off in the consolation game. Puck drop is 1 p.m. tomorrow. The winners will play for the trophy at 4 p.m. We are going to have whichever game UMass Boston plays. The Beacons coming into this one after a four-point weekend that kind of took what you might have expected and stood it on its head. They came into a game against William Smith College, won it 2-1 last Friday. Despite the win, there is a lot to be worried about for head coach Danielle Blanchard's squad. It was a little bit disorganized. It was sloppy. They were missing connections. The passes were not crisp, and they were not especially active. They were susceptible to the pressure of the Herons. They won 2-1. They gave up some penalties. They knew they couldn't afford to do it the next day because the next day was Elmira, not just the new favorite in the New England Hockey Conference, but the fifth-ranked team in the nation in the USCHO poll. So what did UMass Boston do? They took them to overtime. They kept it scoreless through three periods. Fantastic game for Victoria Kennedy. 42 saves for her. That is a career high for the young netminder. She'll be an interesting one to watch in this one to see how well she can carry over the momentum from week to week. But apart from the saves, the defense was quite simply superb in all areas of the ice. Granted, they got a little tired toward the end, and it was hard to keep up in the three-on-three overtime. That'll happen when you've got not quite as deep a roster, not quite as many players as some of their opponents have. But they hung tough. They put on a major show, sticks in the passing lanes, breaking up everything in front of the net. Victoria Kennedy did a fantastic job in goal, not just stopping breakaway shots she had no business stopping, but also controlling the rebounds in a way that her goaltender opposite, Leonie Louise Kuhberger, had a little bit of trouble doing. Elmira's had a dominant top line. That top line ultimately produced the game-winning goal that gave Elmira the extra point in the overtime period. Came courtesy of Emily Crocker, the top line center who scored about more goals in her collegiate career than there are stars in the sky. But still a lot for UMass Boston to be happy about, even though they knew they had an extra point within reach. They had opportunities on the power play they probably wish they could have back, but it's hard to be too unhappy after getting a point against one of the toughest squads at the Division III level. We're going to show you a few highlights from that game and get to some analysis and preview for this one. Stick around. the anthem plays. We're going to get you a look at some of the team stat breakdowns here. UMass Boston coming into this game with a 3-4-0 record. Most of those games in conference. Trine comes in with a 1-7-0 record. We'll talk a little bit more about that in a second. But the pairwise rankings out of 71 teams, UMass Boston just ahead of the midway point there at 34th in the nation. Trine trailing behind at 59th. The other two teams in the tournament, Stevenson and Bowdoin, are a few spots on either side of Trine at 54 and 62 respectively. You get a look at the team stats here. You see in a lot of ways they are similar. You look at the goals per game stat. You look at the goals allowed per game stat. Other than UMass Boston's being completely identical, you can get a look at the strength of schedule and you realize that Trine is coming in here at a little bit of a disadvantage. UMass Boston flinging more shots on net. The penalty minutes roughly even. Trine's got a slightly better power play. UMass Boston has a better penalty kill. We're going to talk more about these matchups as the game goes. But first and foremost, we've got a couple of players that we want to highlight for you. On the UMass Boston side, it's number 26, Kelsey Ryan. Ryan is the top line center, joining Anna Gustafson and Katie Leffler out there on the top line. It's coming to this one in 7 games so far this year, 3 goals and an assist to her name, 25 and 20 in those categories throughout a long and fruitful UMass Boston career. On the Trine side, the highlight, the player to watch is Brandy Wilson. She's wearing number 10. She leads them in goals, tied for the lead in assist, leads in points, in power play goals. She flings more shots on net than any of her compatriots out there on their top line. The top line for Trine is going to be Ellie Warhoftig, Emily Moore, Kaylee Mleko out there. Brandy Wilson's going to be on the second line. Opening shot comes in on Kennedy, squirts wide of the post. We are away here from the Edward T. Berry ice rink. UMass Boston already trying on the counter rush. Kelsey Ryan, shot to the chest of Emily Nettesheim. Got UMass Boston here in their home blues with the black and blue lettering and trim. Trine University in their road blacks there with the gold and white. Face off in the UMass Boston offensive zone, taken there by the Thunder. Trying to break out here. Aggressive forecheck right off the bat from UMass Boston. We saw that in the Elmira game a week ago. To great effect. They got the sticks in the passing lanes. They prevented the odd man rushes that the forecheck can present when it goes wrong. Katie Leffler controlling it with a skate. Handoff here in neutral ice. It's going to be Anna Gustafson. Stick blocked there as she came in. Her teammates are going to join her as she scrambles for it behind the net and loses possession of one of the Thunder skaters. Rachel Burum blocked in front of the net there by Annabelle Scriver of the Thunder. Haley Kozik now moving out from behind the goal. Kozik now retaining possession just under a minute into the first period. Kozik flings it in front of net with a centering pass, no good. Squirts loose here. Who's chasing it down? It's Liz Cramp of the Beacons. Behind the net, looking into the slot. Instead dumps it off, a missed pass there, and giving chase of the Beacons all the way into their own defensive zone. Gives an opportunity for a line change there for Tom Hoffman's Trine University Thunder. And now Danielle Blanchard counters with the same, going to her second line. Comes Allie Riefler pursuing behind the net. UMass Boston largely keeping it in their own offensive zone. They are favored in this one. Juke move comes out in front. Hannah MacDougall and Allie Riefler battling for it. Poked away there. It's Peyton Hans giving chase. Jane Andrill, the UMass Boston defenseman, ultimately comes up with it. Try to break out. Play there is broken up by Demerick of the Thunder. Devin Demerick, one of the two captains on this team, third line at left defense. The other captain would be Emily Moore, the top line center. Puck flung behind the UMass Boston net. A little bit of a hang up there on the line change, but they ultimately get the skaters out and it's in their own defensive zone. swooping behind the net now. Thunder with the first sustained offensive zone time they've had. Missed on the one-timer chance there was Mleko. And the shot comes right into the chest of Victoria Kennedy. Kennedy, 42 saves against Elmira. Stood on her head, made the sort of saves you wouldn't necessarily expect a goalie to make of any skill level at any level. Pad save kicked off there. Comes around to the net. Her teammate Addie Buddington there swapping it away from the net. And there will be a battle for it on the boards. Kennedy stopping breakaways, pad saves, glove saves, big drives from the point. Every sort of shot you can fathom, and she had them all as we get our first icing call of the game. Emily Moore slides off the ice, as does Ellie Warhoftig in the first line. Right now, Brandi Wilson stepping to take the faceoff. Highlighted her in the pregame, a team leading 5 goals. 5 assists to her name as well for the senior from Fenton, Michigan. UMass Boston, again aggressive on the forecheck. Giving chase now is Anna Gustafsson in the Trine defensive zone. Brandi Wilson, stick checked away. Beautiful play there by Addie Buddington of the Beacons. Stole the cookies without a second thought. Corinne Tretchell's going to dump it down. She'll swerve to the bench for a change. On in her stead is Gabby Shantz for head coach Danielle Blanchard of the Beacons. 4 minutes in, still no score, still no really dangerous opportunities for either squad. But UMass Boston has controlled most of the offensive zone time. Last week's game, more than 100 shots total, about two-thirds of them on goal, just through the regulation period before they got to the 3-on-3 overtime. Like we said, UMass Boston has one Codfish Bowl title on the women's side to their name. In 26 games, they are 12-14 all-time. For Trine University, this is the first time they have played in it. Their very first appearance. Bowdoin College has not played either. Stevenson has played 12 games. Excuse me. My apologies. Misread the sheet. Stevenson and Bowdoin are tied with 12 appearances apiece. They are both 6-6. That would put them second, or both tied for second behind UMass Boston in terms of most appearances on the women's side. Sliding in Katie Wilbert, dispossessed. Now the Beacons will try to give chase, but Trine has the angle here. Sprinting. Oh, and taking a spill there is Wilbert, immediately pops up. It was Grace Canty there trying to lead the breakout, and here comes McDougal. Whiffs on the pass, eventually gets it, but Allie Riefler couldn't handle the pass. And a big opportunity for the Beacons here evaporates. Battle in the right dot. Grace Canty now trying to break out on the right side again. This time, Corinne Tretchell says no. Beacons go for a change. Annabelle Scriver waiting for her teammates to join her after the change as well. They're still missing a player. Trine was playing with 4 skaters on the ice for a minute there. And here's Leffler up the middle. Leffler to the doorstep. Hook around, puck still loose. And squibs behind the goal. Katie Leffler with one of the big chances for the Beacons early on. 5.5 minutes gone, still nothing doing for either squad on the scoreboard. UMass Boston stand heavy on that forecheck. Now here's a chance. Emily Moore, shot blocked in front. Nice defensive recovery there by the UMass Boston forward. It's going to be Melina Maggio. Call out there on the side. We are going to have a face-off in the neutral zone, it would seem. UMass Boston opting for some subs. It's going to be the second line of Kaylee Kozik, Rachel Burum, Liz Cramp out there, along with the first line defense, Addie Buddington, and the second line defender, Corinne Tretchell. Head coach Danielle Blanchard. And a big giveaway here. Burum behind the net. Cramp centering pass, sticked away. Head coach Danielle Blanchard largely choosing to keep the lines constant. Just because of how few players she has, they may be getting some reinforcements over winter break. That remains to be seen. But for the meantime, wanting to keep the lines together to build that chemistry, try to cope with the fatigue. Conditioning is important. They're usually playing with fewer skaters on the roster than are their opponents. Serving behind the net now is Natasha Sterbiak. Tries to flip it over to her teammate Gabrielle Hicks. And here comes Grace Canty. Fires a shot on Kennedy, and Kennedy sticks it to the chest. Got glue plastered all over the way she plays sometimes. The rebound control through the opening 7 minutes and through the last game they played against Elmira was as close to immaculate as you could want. Fantastic play in net for the sophomore. This is her first year. UMass Boston did not play during the pandemic last season. 7 minutes gone now, still no score. Three shots on goal for Trine University, two for UMass Boston. Dumping it down here is Hannah McDougall, and Emily Nettesheim covers it up in the crease. Trine University entering this one 1-7, 59th in the pairwise. They had one win against Stevenson, one of the other Codfish Bowl teams. Either UMass Boston or Trine will be playing Stevenson tomorrow. Since then, seven consecutive losses for the Thunder. The last five of them all multi-goal losses. We got an icing call here. And it'll be an offensive zone face-off in the UMass Boston zone. Since then, seven losses. The first two of them one-goal losses. The next five multi-goal losses. Three of them by three goals, one of them by six goals. They have not played particularly brilliantly in recent weeks. They're looking for a big rebound game or two here at the Codfish Bowl. Face-off won by Trine, but they're figuring out how to get it out from behind the net. Missed pass down on the breakout. Addie Buddington's got a head start to it as it sails behind the goal. Looking for Leffler. Instead, it's Jane Andrill behind the net. Missed pass there, and now they've got to contend with the added pressure. Nice pass there. Leffler sailing into the neutral zone, into the offensive zone, to the slot. Fires, looked like it might have been a pad on it from Nettesheim in goal. Stays in the offensive zone for the Beacons. And here they come the other way. It's Brandy Wilson to the dot. Fires again to the stomach of the netminder, Kennedy. It's coming way out from the crease to make herself big. She's only 5'3", 4 inches shorter than her opposite in net, Emily Nettesheim. With a name like that, Emily Nettesheim is born to be a goalie. Puck comes behind the goal, squibs through, ejected there by UMass Boston. Sterbiak missed getting a stick to it. Oh, and a breakout chance there, almost materialized. Almost a tripping call in the neutral zone there. Refs are going to let him play. The Elmira game pretty devoid of penalties. We did not see one for a while. Kaylee Kozik, beautiful dangle move. But no dice there for the senior. Centering pass there, broken up Jane Andrill. Here she comes the other way, a pass flung up ahead. Target was McDougall, didn't get there. Drill pokes it down and will go for a change. Kozik off the ice as well, along with Riefler. Puck squibs loose. And a wrister there, a slap shot coming from Melina Maggio. She will give way. Most of the shots that we have seen have not been particularly ripe chances. Not to say that they've been bad, but they've all been about mid-range line drive tries. We have not seen plentiful rebounds. We have not seen too many dangerous mistakes in the slot. Another shot flung in there from the point. No good. Loose puck and out in front. Stick save and covered up on the rebound there by Nettesheim. UMass Boston seems to be going for the element of surprise here, flinging shots from odd angles, seeing what they can earn from it. Face-off here in their zone, the Beacons control. To the dot here, it's Kelsey Ryan. Centering pass, puck's loose in the crease. Tip shot. And it floats harmlessly behind the net. UMass Boston forcing some dangerous loose pucks here. But here comes Brandi Wilson in the Thunder. She's got DiMaggio behind her. Nice leave-off pass. Poked away from behind by Gustafson. UMass Boston showing the active sticks that we saw against Elmira. And an icing call. Beacons opt for a change. Liz Cramp off the ice. Melina Maggio as well. Gabby Shantz coming off. So it'll be Burum and Leffler. It'll be Tretchel, Shantz, and Gustafson out there for Danielle Blanchard. A little more than halfway done now in the first period. Very few dangerous chances for either squad. And no goals on the board for either team as well. Loose puck centering pass. It's a giveaway. Shot sails high there. Peyton Hans on the shot. Third line forward on the right side. Brief pause here. Melina Maggio comes on. Addie Buddington subs off. And here comes the faceoff. UMass Boston wins it. Another giveaway in their own zone. Puck sticked in there and covered up quickly by Victoria Kennedy. Puck was loose for ever so slight a moment. And the Thunder looked to pounce. So after controlling possession and the pace of play, for a little while here, UMass Boston has started to let Trine get some serious time in front of Victoria Kennedy. Flung off the boards here, swings into the neutral zone, recovered there by Trine, poked away. Here's a chance, it's Cramp, fires, pad save, Nettesheim. UMass Boston keeps it in, Cramp goes again, deflected high. Liz Cramp recovers again as she got a third shot in her. No, she's going to leave it off. Centering pass here, Jane Andrill pokes it in. Burum fires point blank bid, no. Sturbiak now. Can the Thunder break out? The forecheck relaxes. Save for Kozik. Peyton Hans now on the far side, weaving through traffic, dispossessed there. Kozik's got it against the boards, fighting for it there with Hans. Puck comes in, deftly sticked away toward the near side boards there by Kennedy. Jade Pandris gives it away. Here's MacDougall, fires on net, blocked there, pad save. It's still loose in the slot. And it comes out to neutral ice. Emily Moore now, looking to go behind the net. Leaves a dump off pass behind her. It's Demerick. Flips it up into the neutral zone, and here's a chance here. Who can get to it first? Gabby Shantz with fantastic speed to beat everyone to the puck. Got a very good read on it down ice and stopped what would have been a breakout chance. 7.5 minutes to play in the opening period. Still no score. Shantz now battling forward in the corner. Getting to it first was Annabelle Scriver of Trine. Loose puck here. Shot. No. Katie Leffler with a wide open look from the slot to the doorstep, and no dice. Nettesheim standing on her head as well as Victoria Kennedy has. Five saves for Kennedy. Nettesheim's had to make 10 of them. Make it 11 along with that one. Make it 12 now as the shots come skittering in from above the right dot. Neutral zone fight. Who's coming up with it? It's going to be the Beacons. Katie Leffler sailing down the right side. Centering pass slides untouched across the slot. Oh, and a nice pass here. It's Hicks. Grace Hicks, that is. Fighting for it, crashing into the boards. Beacons trying to take it there. There's another giveaway. They've had a few of those in their own zone. Passes that have gone right to Trine University players. Here comes Katie Leffler. She's been all over the place in the early going, giving her teammates a chance for a line change. She continues to pursue in the zone. She gets it back. Flings in a long one. Looked like a shot. She just wants to head off the ice. Indeed, she will. Kaylee Kozik, the assistant captain, taking her place. Six and a half minutes to play in the first period. UMass Boston has not scored a goal since their game on Friday, last Friday, 8 days ago against William Smith College when they got a pair. It was the game winner scored by Kaylee Kozik. It was a shorthanded goal. Coming out of a 3-on-5, they went to the 4-on-5. Kozik took advantage of a falling defender, had a beautiful dangle move into the middle, and scored the winner. UMass Boston has not had a goal since in what is now almost five periods worth of time. Whistle blows, and we're going to have a face-off in the opposite zone there. Looked like UMass Boston may have entered offside by just a hair. Six minutes to play in the opening frame. Face-off in the UMass Boston zone, and the Beacons take it. It's Gabby Shantz flying behind the net. Pass skitters along the boards. They're trying to break out with it. Kept in by Trine. Here's UMass Boston. Beautiful pass in here in the neutral zone. Sliding, sticked away there on the shot from Allie Riefler. Here's Trine sliding across. Nice pass into the center of the ice. It's Ellie Warhoftig from the top line. Emily Moore out there with her. Kirsten Vandenhoevel as well. Vandenhoevel calling for it above the left dot. Slides it back down to Mleko, Kaylee Mleko. But no good chance materializes despite the nice pass work. Scriver flings it down. Warhoftig and Moore go to the bench. Teresa DiMaggio and Brandy Wilson from the second line rejoining the festivities. Oh, Grace Hicks, turnover. Sliding in around Shantz, around the net, into a thicket of bodies, covered up by Kennedy. 4:44 to play. Still the defenses have held tight. UMass Boston has had a few turnovers on the breakout that almost cost them. A few rebounds on the Trine side. But generally speaking, there have not been a ton of big defensive miscues. And the opportunities have been a little bit scarce as a result. Anna Gustafson, pass broken up. And now the Beacons will have to chase it down in their own zone. You'll see Ryan pokes it softly into the teeth of a Trine defender. Puck is loose. Oh, and ejected there by Drill. Jane Ann Drill. Vince's stalwart all season for Danielle Blanchard's UMass Boston Beacons. Comes out to Vandenhoevel. Makes it all the way through, but a nice job sealing the post by Kennedy. Gustafson, nice job sealing the puck there. Little spin move there, using her body to shield it. Puck is loose. It's going to come all the way over to the back blue line here, where Scriver retrieves. They're trying to catch the Beacons in a line change here. Vandenhoevel flings another one from distance, and Kennedy calmly snags it. UMass Boston leading 18-11 in shots. Make it 18-12. 14-8 in shots on goal. Yet still no goals. Corinne Tretchell behind the net. Burum all the way down. And finally, an icing call. It was a little bit delayed there from the far side official. .317 to go, and another faceoff here. Trine getting a lot of time in this zone. They have kept the pressure on. The 1-17 coming in here to play a 3-4 team with a 3-4 team that's had a stronger strength of schedule here and is up 25 spots in the pairwise, but you would not know it from watching this game. Trine has played them very nicely. Oh, chance in front. It's Canty. Whoa, to the butterfly goes Kennedy. Nothing gets by. Three minutes and change remaining on the clock. Oh, and here's a chance missed there by Leffler. But the chance is still there. Gustafsson centering pass to Leffler, skitters through. It's been hard to connect the passes in tight quarters. Slap shot sails wide from Jane Andrill. Pass comes into the right dot. Here's a chance. Kelsey Ryan deflected. It's still loose. Oh, and just pushed away there by Nettesheim. Looks like we've got the stick and the glove of Nettesheim both coming off in the scrum. Oh, and she may have gotten hit. Emily Nettesheim surrounded by some concerned-looking teammates here. It's 2:34 to play. The glove came off. You can see the bare hand is out. There was a scrum of bodies in front of the net. I don't want to speculate here on what her condition is. She seems like she is good enough to continue. Hope she's doing okay. She's going to be challenged right away, perhaps? No. Trine takes the faceoff. Pass comes to Ryan. Pad save there. To the pads and then the glove. Nettesheim is tested immediately after the hit. .223 remaining. Battle on the boards. Who's coming out with it? It's McDougal. Fires in on net. Puck is loose. And corralled by Nettesheim. Just 12 seconds and already back to the faceoff. Puck squibbed over to the boards. Trying to break out with it, but once again, the Beacon's forecheck has given him some problems. Beacon's forecheck has been pretty consistent throughout this first period. It's made it difficult for Trine. Trine's done a good job keeping the puck in the offensive zone once they get there. And here's a breakout chance. It's behind the net now, but Hans gets to it first. Mishandles it behind the net, though, and Jane Andrill with a chance to eject. Finds McDougal on the far side boards. Centering pass broken up there, and a furious Katie Wilbert. She wanted that breakaway chance. Grace Canty tipped in. Loose puck deflected wide. Minute and a half to play. Kozik and Vandenhoevel. Now Kozik and Canty. Canty's been all over the place in the offensive zone so far for the Trine University Thunder. Oh, and here's a chance for Kozik. Up the middle. She's got a lane. Oh, poked away there by Vandenhoevel to stop the momentum. Comes out, Shantz fires off a skate of Cramp, who immediately hits the ice. Under a minute to play. Annabelle Scriver sails the puck over the forecheck there. Wilson corrals. UMass Boston trying to recover. Kennedy opts to cover it up. ...4 14th annual Codfish Bowl. The opening game is scoreless through the opening 19 minutes and change. Bowdoin College and Stevenson University going to play after this one. The losers play tomorrow at 1 p.m. The winners play at 4. UMass Boston looking to win their first Codfish Bowl in a little while. Puck squibs behind the net. Oh, coming in hot there are the Beacons. Centering pass to Kozik, and it's broken up. Retrieving it in the neutral zone is Shantz. Oh, and now it's poked away. Chance here from Lecko, and Kennedy snags it to the chest. Kennedy coming well out of the crease to play a lot of these breakaway chances. UMass Boston. Losing the faceoff in their own zone. Kennedy has to stick away a dangerous shot out in front. Last chance for the Beacons in the period. Leffler plays broken up. Gustafsson giving chase. 3 seconds to play, and that is how the period will end. Close fighting, close action, and battles for all the pucks. And in the end, we're still scoreless through the opening 20 minutes. 24-17, UMass Boston leading the shots category, leading 18-13 in shots on goal. No penalties, no goals through the opening 20. We're going to kick you to a quick video here about another event we've got going on in the gym next door. That would be the Black Coaches Classic. Four men's basketball teams. Tufts and Leslie facing off at 5 p.m. Brandeis and UMass Boston at 7:30 p.m. I'm going to show you what the coaches think about this, why they put it together, and what the importance of it is to them. Then we'll be back with some first half analysis and updates from the New England Hockey Conference and the rest of Beaconville. Stick around.
Concept for the event came to me just kind of through talking with other coaches in the business on both men's and women's side. I think the common theme was that we all were a little frustrated at times when we were assistant coaches with, you know, kind of the lack of advancement and the stigmas that were being placed on us as, you know, only a recruiter, things of those sort. So, you know, kind of came out of that, I think, with conversations and I think like everybody, I spent a long, long time and a lot of hours on Zoom with a lot of conversation and access to coaches that I probably wouldn't have had in a normal year.
My first reaction was it was a no-brainer. I've known Jay for a long time, and you know, obviously with everything that's gone on over the last couple of years with social justice and, you know, athletics and just the world in general, I thought it'd be a great opportunity for us to be part of it.
You know, I think the event would have been important 18 years ago. I think the event is important now. I think with everything going on, I think it's important. You know, we've read all those statements of support, you know, all these departments, athletic departments and coaches and schools. So I think now it's time.
I think it's important just because there's an attention on it. You know, unfortunately, due to, you know, recent events in our country, it's, you know, brought an awareness and has opened up some eyes and ears that maybe for a little while was a little bit dormant. So I think it's just important to capitalize on that attention that's currently there, and again, do it in a way that celebrates as opposed to you know, something that's, you know, pointing a finger. And we just got to keep that momentum and, you know, keep getting our stories out there and getting our faces out there and just normalizing it, honestly, so that people could see that, hey, these guys are getting it done. You know, maybe that'll open the door for some more down the road.
We're not shying away from the issue. I think that's really the main thing. It just, like I said, it shows some type of recognition that there are places that, you know, are giving Black coaches opportunity. You know, I think that this event is, you know, a step in the right direction. Of course, it's a lot more things that, you know, need to improve in society. But I think, you know, having an event like this and, you know, putting some light on it is definitely a step in the right direction.
A great way to shine a light on, you know, the awareness of, you know, the amount of black coaches that are at the D3 level in our state, but also to celebrate the coaches that are, you know, at this level and doing it. And I think there's a certain responsibility that comes with, you know, being in the seat that I'm fortunate enough to be in. And, you know, I think the more that, you know, we could bring light to it and awareness to it to hopefully set the path for, you know, future guys to follow, as well as also showcase, you know, what we're capable of as black men coaching.
It gives a lot of recognition to, you know, the black coaches and I guess all the black people that would like to eventually get into coaching one day. Have an event like this, to have all of these black coaches to coach against each other, all in the same event, I think that is rare. And I think it's a special event.
It's going to help the growth of, you know, younger coaches believing that they have a chance to be successful, believing they have a chance to get a shot to coach at the Division III level of being a head coach. I think it definitely sheds light on some of the things that's been going on as far as, you know, minority coaches getting opportunities to coach. It's going to be one night where you get the chance to see four coaches coming from four really good universities compete.
I hope that there are great games, great competition. And I'm sure that there'll be a high skill level for sure of competition. I mean, I'm just looking forward to all of that skill level to be shown, you know, by programs that are ran by black coaches.
Obviously, you know, I'm hoping obviously to get a win. That's one. Two, you know, obviously just to interact with some of these other coaches going to be involved in the event, to have our players interact with their players. Bond that lasts for a long period of time, and also to show our kids in the other schools, their kids, that, you know, again, anything's possible if you put your mind to it.
And for our players, I think it's you know, important for them to be able to see, you know, black faces in a position of leadership. You know, not that that they don't see that or that they don't appreciate it, but I think, you know, the more the merrier, you know, the more examples that they could get to see that black people could, you know, be in these roles, the better. Because when they graduate, they're all going to be in positions to either work for, you know, black people or, you know, potentially have to hire and make decisions on black people. So I think the more positive examples that they could have as they embark on their professional careers is the best thing that that hopefully this event could continue to provide.
So I hope that we can have more faces on the television. So I hope that more kids, now that they're younger, they're watching the game, they're mesmerized by the faces on TV the way I was mesmerized by John Thompson, John Chaney, Nolan Richardson, Doc Rivers, those guys, and even following for Charlie Titus, right? So I want young kids now to look over on the bench and see, like, hey, that guy's in charge of a $1 billion corporation, the Celtics. That guy's in charge of the world-renowned university, Tufts, Brandeis. That guy went back and played for his alma mater, and now he's, you know, the head coach there, Leslie. So, you know, that's what I want from it. I want other people to take things from it. I just want to be able to give.
Welcome back, everyone. I'm Milton Posner. Thank you so much for joining us here today on the Beacon's Broadcast Network. I'm going to give you a little bit of information about the Codfish Bowl, but first we're going to go to the first period stats. We're going to take a look at some of the things that we have seen so far today. You can see UMass Boston with an advantage in the shots category. They have had more valuable chances, in particular loose pucks, little bit of rebound control issues for Nettesheim, although she has been very good overall. There have been a couple of loose pucks there that her defenders have not been able to eject through the UMass Boston forecheck. No power plays so far, just as there was in UMass Boston's last game against Elmira. There were few penalties, and they came in the later part of the game. We're going to take a look at the New England Hockey Conference's out-of-town scoreboard. UMass Boston not playing in conference this weekend, but we've got some other teams doing so. Johnson and Wales going to be facing off against Connecticut College at 3 p.m. Elmira squaring off against Middlebury. That's going to be a matchup of powerhouses at 6. We have got a couple games tomorrow. Salem State and Trinity College. Time still to be announced on that one. And Johnson and Wales taking on Amherst. Now to the look around Beaconville to see what else UMass Boston's got going for them. And as we alluded earlier, the men's basketball team going to be playing against Brandeis, number 25 Brandeis, at the Black Coaches Classic here. The men's hockey team playing against the number one ranked SUNY Geneseo team yesterday, losing 6-2 despite leading in shots. They will square off against Amherst College at 4 p.m., so you'll have somewhere to go when this one wraps up. Taking a look ahead, tomorrow the women's hockey team is going to be playing so the winners play tomorrow, the losers play tomorrow, so we will know when the women's hockey squad is playing at the conclusion of this one. We'll know who they are playing when the second game today between Stevenson and Bowdoin has concluded. Looking ahead past that, it's December 7th against Connecticut College, December 10th at number 2 Middlebury College. Those are going to be the last two games they play before the school goes to winter break. On January 2nd, they will return with a road game at Amherst College and then another road game 5 days later at Plymouth State. Most of those conference games, and for that matter, UMass Boston's got to savor this. Today and tomorrow are going to be their last home games until mid-January. We want to take full advantage of the home, of the friendly confines, and get a couple of wins here, even out of conference. It'll help a team. This is a young team, not a particularly deep team. I don't mean that in terms of skill. I just mean that purely in terms of how many players they have. This is a team that needs chemistry, conditioning, and a feeling like they've got wind in their sails in every respect here. Head coach Danielle Blanchard coming in late, hired just 12 days before the season opener against Suffolk University, and has been trying to cobble together a functioning team. She has done a remarkable job in that respect. Given how late she came in and given that this has been a very competent team, bordering on excellent in some of their games. That said, still tied at 0 goals apiece with Trine, and you want to see them ideally pick up the pace a little bit. This is a team they absolutely can and should beat. But before we get back into the action, a little bit of history here about the Codfish Bowl. This tournament, older than you might think, founded in 1965 by Eddie Berry and athletic director Gus Sullivan at Boston State. Boston State would eventually be absorbed into UMass Boston. But Berry said, we already had the bean pot at the time. College hockey was just the two divisions. It was large schools and it was the small schools. And this was a chance to showcase teams like ours. The bean pot, of course, for those who didn't grow up in New England, is a four-team tournament. There is a men's and a women's iteration. It takes place in the first and second Mondays in February for the men, first and second Tuesdays in February for the women. Northeastern University, go Huskies, BC, BU, and Harvard playing in that one. And so this was intended to be the small school hockey counterpart, the Codfish Bowl. It is now the oldest Division III hockey tournament. It is the second oldest existing tournament, second only to the Bean Pot at any level. UMass Boston took the first one. Back then it was just a men's competition when it first started. Barry was just about building Boston State into a powerhouse. It eventually, this was the start of his 20-year reign as head coach, during which the team won a couple of ECAC Division II tournaments, a couple of NAIA tournaments, had an undefeated 20-0 season in 1965. They were a team to be feared at that point. Barry said before he died a few years ago, he said, "I still get calls and letters from my players at Boston State, knowing them, knowing the Codfish Bowl is still held. Very special to me." It was a showcase for the smaller college hockey schools. It still is, even with the divisional realignments, even with the merger of Boston State with UMass Boston, just led to the Beacons absorbing the tournament. It predates the divisions. UMass Boston still the only constant competitor. The men's team won 6 times as Boston State, 5 times as UMass Boston. 1983, 97, 07, 13, and 14. For the women, 2014, and that's it. They're looking for a second trophy here. A little bit more on Ed Barry. A guy with a fascinating life and a fascinating career, to the point that the building that you've been looking at this whole time on your screen, the ice rink is named for him. That's the Ed Barry we're talking about. Played briefly for Northeastern in college, hopped to the EHL Boston Olympics farm team, became the first American since the 1920s to play for the Boston Bruins, and then jumped to Boston State. He's a member of the Northeastern and UMass Boston Halls of Fame, and his legacy lives on here as we start the second period of the tournament he founded. The men's iteration going to its 56th running on December 29th and 30th with UMass Boston, University of Rhode Island, Post University, and Franklin Pierce University. The 14th women's iteration underway here with UMass Boston looking to beat a very beatable trying team that they have so far not been able to get too much of an edge on. Gustafson trying to break through the neutral zone here. UMass Boston's going to keep the pressure on. Battle here, Vandenhoevel recovers. Again, aggressive forechecking there. Teresa DiMaggio having to contend with Kelsey Ryan. She just takes it away. Vandenhoevel breaks up the breakout pass. It was a little bit lagging behind, forced Katie Leffler to stay where she was, and it'll give Trine a chance for a line change. Turnover here, another UMass Boston turnover in their own defensive zone, but they recover. Katie Leffler giving chase, Annabelle Scriver giving chase. Leffler surrounded by Thunder players here. Trying to wait for some reinforcements here. She gets Rachel Burem over. Puck is loose. Whiffs on the centering pass. Comes into the slot, and Nettesheim clutches it. A little bit of sloppy play from both squads to start the period, but it ultimately ends with a chance for UMass Boston. Now they'll have a face-off in their offensive zone. Fighting for it is Kozik. Scriver's been all over the place. Liz Cramp's going to take it now into the slot. Sticked up, lands behind the goal. It wound up in the rafters. Looks like it caromed off one of the beams in the ceiling. You can't see them on the angle you're looking at. A little bit higher up into the ceiling, maybe 25 or so feet off the ice. That one really got up there. Puck poked loose again. Minute and a half into the second period here, no score. Last game against Elmira, we had to wait for at 63 minutes of action before we saw a puck into the back of the net. Here's Kaylee Mleko trying to change that. No dice. Sliding grab from Victoria Kennedy. 15th save for Kennedy, 19 for Nettesheim opposite her. Well, the good times don't roll for very long, apparently. I'd be fine if they kept that going during play, honestly. Can't go wrong with the cars. Dumped in here by Katie Wilbert, giving chase is her teammate Allie Riefler. Taking a spill over there near Riefler is Devin Demerick of Trine. Coming into the middle, Grace Canty, beautiful stick work there, leaves it off for Peyton Hans. Hans swooping down the left side, behind the net, looking for a teammate, looking for a centering pass. It's poked away, Canty giving chase. Grace Canty has been absolutely everywhere for the Thunder. He's fired four shots, all of them on goal. A couple of them very dangerous chances in the first period. Shriver flings it in. Kennedy got a late break on it. She was screened by Melina Maggio, her teammate in front. But ultimately, that shot wasn't going to do a whole lot anyway. Some reinforcements for the Beacons. Anna Gustafson, Kelsey Ryan, Corinne Tretchell, Katie Leffler, and Addie Buddington out there for head coach Danielle Blanchard. Can they take the faceoff? No, it'll be Trine's puck. Shriver flings it in, caroms into the near side corner. Squirts out to the blue line. They keep it in the neutral zone. Pass broken up there. Active play by Kelsey Ryan, the captain. Kelsey Ryan tried a little duck through move. Didn't quite work. Vandenhoevel got there first. UMass Boston keeps it in. Gustafson, and it's kicked away there by Brandy Wilson. Centering pass there, stays behind the net. Trine looking to eject it. Katie Leffler, that is, coming over to break up the play. Shriver squibs it down just wide of Kennedy's net, and that'll go for an icing. Trine has controlled the faceoffs pretty well. 22-12 so far over the Beacons. It's the only category where they're really showing a marked advantage, although they are catching up in the shots category here. Four shots on goal so far in this period to UMass Boston's two. Here's Kaylee Kozik into the slot. Shot, score! Tipped in. It looked like it was Liz Cramp. And the Beacons finally get themselves on the board. Second goal of the year for the freshman Liz Cramp. And the Beacons with a rejuvenated look and a spring in their step. It was just 4 minutes into the second period. They draw first blood. Shot came in from Kozik, made her way into the slot. Looked like it was going wide, and Liz Cramp deftly tipped it inside the right post. Breakout chance here. Kozik looking for her own, slings it on toward the net. No dice. That one sails wide to the post, and this time Cramp's not there to fix it. Sticked away out in front, Jade Pandris looking for a teammate. Finds Gabrielle Hicks. Slides that one all the way down for an icing, and another faceoff in the UMass Boston offensive zone. Kozik gets the assist. That is her fourth assist of the year. Make it fifth assist of the year. And her 21st as a Beacon. Poke down toward the line. Two-on-one battle for it. Emily Moore is waiting to join in when the time is appropriate. Instead, it's going to be UMass Boston taking it behind the net. It's poked away. Chance in front here, and the puck slides harmlessly through the slot. Nelson fighting for it. Hannah Nelson, that is, for the Trine University Thunder. Demerick to Vandenhoevel, trying to break through the UMass Boston forecheck. No dice, says Katie Leffler. Dump off pass misses Jane Andrill, and now she'll have to battle along the boards. Trine takes it. Puck popped up in front of the official Capazzi. Here comes Leffler, loose puck in front. Poked away. Leffler slides it across. Jane Andrill giving chase, but it's Grace Canty to retrieve it. UMass Boston has got their aggression back. Rejuvenated by the Liz Cramp goal. Oh, and taken away there. Melina Maggio on the forecheck. Puck comes back into the neutral zone. Addie Buddington just onto the ice to receive it. Corinne Tretchell as well. Katie Leffler still on there. She's had a long shift. Comes through. Kelsey Ryan. Pass into the middle. And they can't beat Nettesheim. But some slick passing there on the rush for the Beacons. They lead it 1-0 with 6 minutes gone in the second period. Faceoff, Trine wins another one. Jade Pandris, turnover, cramp, shot, oh, and just denied it would have been her second goal. My nice block in front there by Jade Pandris. Trine University trying to get the puck out of the UMass Boston zone, and they do, but the Beacons control. Pass comes up to Leffler. Swinging through. Gabby Schantz above the left dot, sailing down below the net. But Scriver's got a good beat on that puck. Kozik takes it away. Oh, she had cramp in front, missed the pass there. It was a brief window. Needed to be a split-second pass to find cramp open in the slot. And instead, it's an icing call with 7 minutes gone in the second. Chance for a line change for UMass Boston before an offensive zone face-off for the Beacons that have kept the puck in the offensive zone for just about the entirety of the second period. It's Wilson stepping up, but she loses the faceoff to the Beacons. Slap shot comes in wide. Nettesheim got a glove to it for good measure. Scriver again behind the net, again fighting for it, this time with Katie Wilbert. Trine slides it cross ice. Chance here for them. Leah Connor squirts down Katie Wilbert, and again, Shriver in the right spot. Allie Riefler trying to seal off the puck, and she does. Pass into the crease. No good, but the Beacons retain. Calling forward at the point is Jane Andrill. Swooping in, Jane Andrill fires on net. Blocked from behind there. Brandy Wilson got a stick to it. This should be an icing call. And indeed it is. 12-12 to play. UMass Boston leading 1-0 on the Liz Cramp goal. A redirect off a pass from Kaylee Kozik. Trine has not had sustained offensive zone time in this period, and this is the kind of pressure that we figured we'd see from UMass Boston. A little bit of a false start there on the faceoff. Too quick to jump to it. It's Brandy Wilson and Kelsey Ryan. Comes to the Beacons. Out to the point. Gabby Schantz flings a wrister in. Beacons control. Keep it in their own offensive zone. Gustafson with a dangle. Oh, too many defenders. One-timer on the way from Katie Leffler, no good, but the Beacons trying to keep it in. Scriver dive into the ice. Battle for it. Who's closest? It's going to be Kelsey Ryan. Tries to fling it into the center. Gustafson dangles through. It's Corinne Tretchell above the left dot. Flings it in, and Nettesheim clutches it. Head coach Tom Hoffman assistant head, associate head coach Melissa Krause on the Trine side, cannot be happy with the inability to clear the UMass Boston forecheck. Danielle Blanchard watching her team get chance after chance. They keep this up. It is only a matter of time before the second goal comes. Shot there from above the right dot. Comes to the glove of Nettesheim. That was Melina Maggio flinging a long shot chance from distance. It'll be Allie Riefler against Grace Canty on the faceoff, and UMass Boston wins it. UMass Boston starting to close the faceoff advantage here. Used to be 10, and now it is 4 for the Thunder. It's the one category where they were reliably beating the Beacons, and with that gone, again, only a matter of time. Jane Andrill to the doorstep, dangle shot. Someone got a stick to it and broke up the pass. Drill calling for it in the slot. Instead, it's Kozik. It's in! UMass Boston with another goal. And they've doubled the lead here in the second period. It's Kaylee Kozik. The junior out of Wexford, Pennsylvania, gets her team leading 4th of the year. And the Beacons, after being stymied in the first period, made an emphatic statement in the second. Drill was calling for it open in the slot, but Kaylee Kosick saw the lane, she saw the angle, and got the job done. Here it comes to Allie Riefler. Disconnect there, crisscrossing with MacDougall. Brandi Wilson taking it through. Another even strength goal for the Beacons. There's a goal. Kozik assisted on the Cramp goal. And Cramp returning the favor, assisting on Kozik's 4th of the year, 2nd of the period for UMass Boston. Rachel Burum also notching an assist on that one. For Cramp, it is her 5th assist of the year. For Burum, it is her 3rd. Moves Cramp into the sole possession of the team lead. She's got 5 assists to Kozik's 4. Here's Katie Leffler. The Beacons want more. Kelsey Ryan on the other side of the net fires a centering pass, but it's broken up. Halfway home in the second period, UMass Boston still reluctant to let the puck outside their offensive zone. Sticked away there on the redirect off the stick of Gustafson. Nettesheim not letting it through. Centering pass squibs through to the far side, to the near side boards. Melina Maggio. Shot comes on, it stick through and dispossessed again. Katie Leffler fired. Her shot is blocked and squibs over the net. Breakout chance here for Trine. DiMaggio. Gabby Hicks. That's Grace Hicks, her sister. My apologies. 25 and 26 on the roster are Grace and Gabrielle Hicks. Leffler got a skater in the middle. Puck is loose in the slot, and it's sticked away. 9 minutes to play. Now here is Gabrielle Hicks. Slingshot, Jane Andrill, nobody there to get it. Kaylee Kozik is closing. And the forecheck forces the errant pass. And a tip redirect on net, covered up by Nettesheim. Eight minutes, 49 to play. Two goals for UMass Boston in the period. The first one from Liz Cramp off the assist from Kaylee Kozik. The second one from Kozik off the assist from Cramp and Rachel Burum. Pass ahead. Peyton Hans has got a chance here. Swerves behind the net. Who she got with her? Fires back to the point. It's Demerick. Shot wide. Rebound. Loose in the slot. Looks like we're going to have a whistle on the play here. Not quite sure of the call yet. Looks like it'll go against UMass Boston. There is a defensive zone face-off for them. And it's going to be the first penalty of the game. So UMass Boston to the penalty kill here. Penalty is going to go against Liz Cramp. Liz Cramp with her second penalty of the season. UMass Boston immediately on the offensive. In case you're curious about the records, Trine has 5 power play goals this season. They have converted 21% of their chances. UMass Boston has allowed 4 power play goals this season. They have stopped the power play on 85% of their tries. Minute 41 remaining. Cramp goes to the sin bin. Try and see if they can use this as an opportunity to at least get some momentum going, but ideally you want to see them get one back here. There have not been... This is the first penalty of the game. Jane Andrill flying through the neutral zone, sticked away there, but she recovers. Whistle on the play. We're going to have a neutral zone face-off. Minute 20 remaining on the Cramp penalty. Jade Pandris. Grace Kent, oh, what a beautiful move in open ice. Disrupted by Kozik there. She's content at this point to just poke it away and burn some time. Halfway home on the power play for Trine University. Grace Canty looking for options. Hesitated a bit too long, and now they've got to recover. Pass comes out to Canty on the right dot. Swerving to the middle. A good give-and-go play there, but Kennedy sealed the post. Just hit the tip of the pad, the left pad of Victoria Kennedy. 35 seconds left on the power play for Trine. Got to get some good chances at net here. They fling it back to the point. It's Vandenhoevel winding up. Deflected as it came through the middle. 25 seconds on the power play. And it squibs all the way down. Trine's going to have maybe one more good look at this. Oh, and they caught UMass Boston in a line change and couldn't do anything with it. 12 seconds remaining on the power play. 7-6-5, and that is how the power play will end, with only one really decent look. And no great ones. UMass Boston holds down the fort on the penalty kill, and now back to even strength. Let's see if they can regain the same forecheck pressure that they had earlier. Comes in. Gustafsson fires on net. Save by Nettesheim. At the very least, Trine needed to get some momentum and some pressure out of that power play. And it seems like that hasn't happened yet. UMass Boston has come right back the other way and stuffed it down their throats. It's Katie Leffler. Slingshot in, broken up. Chance for a breakout for Trine, no. UMass Boston keeps it in, now they got numbers. Pass broken up, Leffler to the far side boards. Fired in, skitters across the crease, and sails wide. 5.5 minutes remaining in the second period. UMass Boston has set up shop in their offensive zone once again. Liz Cramp fighting for it behind the net. It goes to Devin Demerica, the Thunder. Kozik swerving. Pass misses Burem. And the puck winds up in the clutches of Kelsey Ryan. Only problem is Kelsey Ryan sitting on the bench. Five minutes and change to play. Face off won again by UMass Boston. Puck comes in, covered up by Nettesheim. Another offensive zone face-off for the Beacons. This time they lose it. Vandenhoevel, can she slide it over? Can they get it even past the dots? Past the dots, yes. Into their offensive zone, yes. But Melina Maggio gets to it first for the Beacons, kicks it back out. Kozik, loose chance here, 2-on-2. On the break, it's Burum with Cramp to her left. Burum down the right side. Burum behind the goal. Flips it. Cramp's got it. They have company now. Kaylee Kozik chasing with Vandenhoevel. Kozik takes it. Into the middle. Sticked away there. Oh, loose puck. It's been a little bit tricky for Emily Nettesheim to control some of the rebounds on these long, big drives from the UMass Boston defenders. Four minutes, 21 seconds remaining. UMass Boston leading it 2-0 on the goals from Liz Cramp and Kaylee Kozik. Taking control of this game in just about every way imaginable in the second period. The shots on goal, which UMass Boston led by 7 in the opening period, they now lead, they're practically doubling up the Thunder at this point. 8 shots on goal for the Thunder, or shots period, I should say. 27 for UMass Boston in the second period. More than a shot per minute so far. Almost a shot and a half per minute. Hannah McDougal giving chase now. Jade Pandrus beats her to it. Under 4 minutes to play. UMass Boston keeps it in. Oh, loose puck. It's Hannah McDougal to the doorstep. She scores! Third goal of the period for UMass Boston. And they're starting to blow this one open here in the second. First goal of the season for Hannah McDougal, the junior out of Dartmouth, Mass. And it came on a crucial turnover. UMass Boston applying the pressure in their offensive zone, and it pays off again. Katie Wilbert and Addie Buddington getting assists on the play for Wilbert. That is her first assist as a Beacon. For Buddington, that's her second assist of the year. Gabby Shantz now. UMass Boston trying to get it out of their own zone. Not so fast, say the Thunder. McDougal stays on the ice after the goal. Sticked away there, sliding rightward across the crease was Nettesheim. Ejected back down now. Shantz, cross ice pass, Jane Andrill. They're moving well. They're passing well. Pinball there, wound up into a thicket of players coming onto the ice. Mleko takes a spill. Brandy Wilson still got a chance. But not if the Beacon's back check has anything to say about it. Gabby Shantz says no. Kozik, Gustafsson now. Matter of who's sliding into the area with some momentum. 2.5 minutes gone. UMass Boston with 3 goals in the period. Kozik, Cramp, and now McDougal. Gustafsson. She's got Katie Wilbert. She's got Burum too, but gets caught up in a boondoggle on the boards. Shriver swings wide. Off the boards, and they pop it down. DiMaggio giving chase. And it's an icing call. Teresa DiMaggio badly trying to save that icing there. Would have had a decent chance at the net had she managed to. But it was not meant to be. Change for the Beacons. Wilbert, MacDougall, Tretchell, Buddington, and Riefler out there for head coach Daniel Blanchard. 2 minutes to go. Whistle blows on the faceoff. We're going to do that one again. Swing wide. Buddington had her shot stuffed. Beacons again trying to keep it in. Teresa DiMaggio. Taken away there. Trine just cannot get a good look at the net. Looks like the puck may have glanced off of a player on the bench, right off the shoulder of, if I'm not mistaken, Leah Connor, the fourth line left forward on the Trine bench. We're going to have a face-off here in the Trine offensive zone. Minute 40 to play. Trine's got to give themselves some reason for hope, some semblance of momentum heading into the period, but UMass Boston has taken control of the shots, of the face-offs, the forecheck, the pressure in general, and they have made Trine pay in some capacity for every critical turnover, every inconvenient loose puck, every hiccup, every misstep. The Beacons have been on it. Three goals in the period after a dry first period. Puck can't make it through to Kennedy. Beacons looking for another. They've got a chance here on the rush. Pass intended for Gustafson, sails a little bit too far in front. Shot comes in on net, covered up by Nettesheim with just under a minute to play. Face off here, UMass Boston takes it yet again. Fight in the near side corner. 45 seconds to play. Trying to give themselves some reason for hope going into the third. Need some momentum, or better yet, a goal. 33 seconds to play. UMass Boston still making it impossible for them to get any kind of momentum going toward their own net. Or can they? Mleko poked away. Gustafson. That is Cramp on the forecheck. 15 seconds to go. Puck slides over in empty ice. Buddington giving chase with 8 seconds to play. Jane Andrill flips it forward. Gustafson going to try one more chance. No, it'll be Kelsey Ryan and no dice. That is how the period will end. UMass Boston with 3 goals to their credit. The first one coming from Liz Cramp on the assist by Kaylee Kozik. The second one coming from Kozik on the assist by Cramp and by Rachel Burum. And then the last one coming courtesy of Hannah McDougall on the breakaway. Beacons taking control of this one. We are going to go to a quick break and be right back. We're going to talk to Katie Flagg. We got a special guest in the house here, NEHC Goaltender of the Year in 2019-20. We're going to see what she thinks about this one and what's up with her hockey career right when we come back. Stick around. We'll be right back. Hey, everybody. Welcome back. We got a very special guest with us today. We got Katie Flagg, formerly of the UMass Boston women's hockey team. And Katie, just to start off with, you've been playing with the Buffalo Buttes professionally. What's it been like for you delving into pro hockey after your college career?
Yeah, obviously my first season wasn't a normal season here. We were in the bubble, so it really wasn't a true pro experience, you'd say, our first year. So obviously this being my first actual season, I like to call it, it's been awesome so far. We luckily have our Canadian players over here, so we were able to kind of get to know each other as a team, and it's been awesome so far. It's a lot more fast-paced than I think I realized at first. Obviously, playing in college, it is a higher level than high school, and then that jump from college to pro, you really don't realize it until you're in that situation. Seeing the players go by practices, how much of a higher pace it actually is.
What do you think was a harder jump for you, jumping from high school to college or jumping now from college to the professional level?
I think there's a difficult thing in both jumps, but I think the jump to pro is probably a little bit harder. Obviously, it being a women's professional league, you have to kind of balance a full-time job mixed with trying to be full-time a hockey player as well. So I think that aspect of it is a pretty difficult jump. But the hockey part of it, I'd say it's pretty similar. Obviously, again, it's a lot faster, but I think the balancing act, full-time job mixed with trying to obviously perform your best on the ice while not missing practices, games, and everything. So I'd say pro so far, just because of all the outside factors.
Well, we got a goalie's perspective here. I'm working without an analyst today. I'm spitballing out here. So let me know, what do you think of how the goalies, how Victoria Kennedy and Emily Nettesheim have been faring in net today?
Yeah, they've been looking pretty good. I'd say it's a goalie game. Obviously now 3-0, UMass finally broke through and put some pucks in the net. But those first two periods, obviously it was a goalie battle. I think they both looked awesome. Victoria Kennedy, this is my first time seeing her really play in person, and I think she's been doing a great job stepping it up. So yeah, continue it, and I think she can obviously have a great season here.
Is there something for her? Because she's a sophomore here coming in, but she's essentially a freshman in terms of in hockey terms, because they didn't play last year. Is there something for her, and other than just kind of adjusting to the speed, that helps new goalies at the college level to play their best as compared to high school?
I think just be confident. Obviously, you were brought in for a reason. You kind of went over the starting job for a reason. And I think don't get too ahead of yourself. You're like, okay, I'm playing well, and I don't have to keep improving or working hard at practice. I'll just be content with where I am. So I think, you know, keep pushing herself at practice, but still be confident in her abilities, because obviously she's a great goalie. You can see that here today. So.
Last question for you. With juggling the full-time job, pursuing hockey in Buffalo, What's the next big goal for you? What's the next thing that you really want to check off your list and get done, either personally, professionally, hockey standpoint?
I think hockey-wise, obviously we want to win an Isabel Cup this year in the league. So I think that's kind of our next goal. Whatever role I have, cheering teammates on, whether I get in those games, play those big games. But I think winning an Isabel Cup is definitely my next goal for sure, definitely.
Well, you got a lot of people here at the program pulling for you and your success. We're going to take a quick break and get back to you with a little bit of analysis of the second period, preview of the third, and a little bit more Codfish Bowl facts. Thank you to Katie Flagg for taking the time to speak with us, and we'll be right back.
these hitters to come in and disrupt the game.
What is that?
In the first period, it was dry, nothing going for either squad. The defense met the offense on even footing, and the shots did not get through. In the second period, the wine flowed freely, and UMass Boston scored three quick, decisive goals. First from Liz Cramp, then from Kaylee Kozik, and then from Hannah McDougal. They lead it 3-0 now against a Trine team that came in as the underdog and is now going to have to mount a Herculean effort to make this a more competitive game. UMass Boston lived in their offensive zone in the last period. We'll see if they can match that energy here in a period where they're coming up in firm control of the game. Trying to break out here. Pass, DiMaggio trying to connect with it. Instead, it's Addie Buddington. Over to Leffler. Katie Leffler flying up the right side here, looking for a centering pass. She's got Gustafson in the middle. And Nettesheim bats it up into the air and snags it. It's 30 seconds in. UMass Boston already mounting a serious assault on net. Puck is down. UMass Boston appears to control the faceoff in a battle on the boards. Half the players on the ice involved in a thicket. Burem giving chase, but Trine emerges with it. For how long can they keep it? Not for very long. Liz Cramp retakes in the neutral zone. Kaylee Kozik swerving around the net, dispossessed behind there by Vandenhoevel. Trying to break out. Turnover, Riefler, and Scriver got a stick in there to break up the shot. Pass across the neutral zone, skitters through to the backside boards behind the UMass Boston net. Pass flung up there, nice read there from Pandris. But failing to tag up there were the Thunder. Got caught in a bad position there. Pandris made a good read. One of her teammates, it appeared it was Moore, was about 5 feet offside in the slot. Puck horseshoe bends all the way around to the far side, still going through into the neutral zone, now into the UMass Boston offensive zone. Giving chase is Katie Wilbert behind the net, catching up to her. Puck is loose. Riefler fighting with Moore. Wilbert behind the net. Turns, fires, centering pass. Nettesheim had the post sealed. Not sure if it ever got through. Throw all the legs and the skates and the sticks. Hannah McDougal, one goal in this game already. Corinne Tretchell fires it in. Loose puck. Shot. Oh, glove save, Nettesheim. A beautiful snag there. A puck that came about 3 inches from sailing through the bars. Face off now. Trine got it initially. It's a shot from Addie Buddington. Sticked away through by Nettesheim, and it goes all the way down behind Victoria Kennedy for an icing. 7:14 to play. Face off in the UMass Boston offensive zone. They were used to that in the second period. UMass Boston not quite taking the lead in the face-off category, but closing enough ground and winning enough critical ones to keep the pressure on the Thunder in the second period. Victoria Kennedy with a nice rebound there, right to her incoming teammate. Now UMass Boston on the break. Centering pass skirts ahead of Katie Leffler. It's loose now, dangerous territory. And a whistle on the play here from the official behind the net. Still waiting on word here. Looks like it's going to be a face-off in the Beacon's offensive zone. 16:49 to play, still 3-0 in favor of UMass Boston behind the goals from Liz Cramp, Kaylee Kozik, and Hannah McDougal. Swerving through, Trine still trying to break out. It's flipped down. Kaylee Kozik's not going to let him. ...16 minutes and change remaining. Burum keeps it in, and the Thunder are really having trouble making anything happen for him here. Wraparound shot, Kozik sails high. Stays in the zone. Going down to the ice is Scriver. UMass Boston emerges with it. Shot! Again high and a little bit wide this time from Kozik. She'll sprint back for the back check, but UMass Boston keeps it in. Puck loose in the slot. Giving chase is Cramp. Looking for her second goal of the game, but not to be that time. Melina Maggio now. Off the boards. Look like I might have caromed off the official. Pass up ahead. Madison Tor of the Thunder opts to toss it down for a full platoon swap here. UMass Boston trying to catch Trine napping. Pass up Katie Wilbert. Slingshot fires, deflected high and into the net. Nettesheim has had to stand on her head so far in the third period, and she has done so. Most goalies cannot cede three goals and still have an elite save percentage, but yet, Emily Nettesheim, 930 save percentage so far, 40 saves against three goals. Make it 41 against 3, and the save percentage is 932. 5 minutes gone in the third period here, and once again, UMass Boston has lived so long in this offensive zone, they might as well ditch the tent for an apartment. Hannah Nelson. Buddington, what a defensive play. The aggression, the precision of the sticks. UMass Boston has been in control for the last 25 plus minutes of game time, but a big turnover there. Dorisa DiMaggio blocked in front. Nelson couldn't quite get to the rebound, and now UMass Boston's got defensive reinforcements in there. Tap back to the point. Slingshot in, skitters across the crease, and harmlessly to the near side corner. Trine keeps it in. First real sustained offensive pressure they've had in a while. Now here comes UMass Boston the other way. Kelsey Ryan with Katie Leffler behind her. Vandenhoevel. Fighting for it along with Leffler. Puck comes to the corner now to the opposite corner on the pass. Liz Cramp giving chase. Taking a spill down there is Trine University back checker. Look like Demerick. Devin Demerick, that is. Still 3-0 UMass. Katie Leffler now. Pirouetting in her defensive zone. In and out move. Still going. Eventually it's poke checked away. She's going to go off the ice. In her stead is Kaylee Kozik. Trine tries to break out and fails. Corinne Tretchell and now Kozik keeping it in. Liz Cramp mixing it up in there. Rachel Burum as well. Melina Maggio. Jane Andrill's just come back onto the ice. 13 minutes to play here. UMass Boston looking to hold the lead. Trine has lost their last seven games, five of them by double digits, four of them by three or more, with one six-goal loss being the particular outlier. Annabelle Scriver now gaining the neutral zone. Poked away. Kozik, who's getting to it first? As usual for Trine, it's Grace Canty. Third line center has played like a top line star today, but not enough all around contributions for Trine to overcome the forecheck, the pressure, the downhill force of UMass Boston, and of course the passing consistency that we saw in doses against Elmira. Deke move, Kozik, no good. Pad save, Nettesheim. 12 minutes to play now. Trine gives chase, UMass Boston swaps a couple of skaters here. Flung in on net, gives a chance for Trine to change a couple of their, it looks like the defenders going to the bench here. Vandenhul coming out onto the ice. Here's Emily Moore swerving into the middle. Puck poked away. She gets it back. Scrambling for it with Gustafson. Grace Hicks now. Trine finally getting a little bit of back and forth action on this one. Kirsten Vandenhoevel mixing it up as well, but it should be an icing call, and indeed it is. 11:23 to go. UMass Boston trying to reapply the pressure. Winner of this game is going to play the winner of the Stevenson Bowden game coming up next. That game will be at 4 p.m. tomorrow right here in this building. The loser of this game will play the loser of the Bowden-Stevenson game. That's the consolation game at 1 o'clock. UMass Boston putting themselves in good position to go back to the Codfish Bowl title game, win their first title since 2014. They've played 26 games, more than double that of any other team. Yet Bowdoin College and Stevenson have three combined championships. UMass Boston just won. Puck loose a little bit, skittering over to the bottom of the left dot. Trine controls for the moment. We're going to see a turnover. Yes, we will. Liz Cramp to the slot, to the dot. Fires sticked wide. Caught a little piece of Nettesheim there. Trying to break out. Ellie Warhoftig. Haven't called her name much despite her being the top line left forward. Have not seen a ton of her presence here. Been a lot more from Brandy Wilson, from Teresa DiMaggio on the second line, from Grace Canty, especially on the third. But it has not been the forwards that have carried the day for the Thunder. Liz Cramp, big hit into the boards there on Grace, or that would be Gabrielle Hicks. Fire shot in, puck is loose. Looked like Nettesheim had control of it. It was knocked loose. And for the second time, Emily Nettesheim dealing with a lot of careening bodies out in her crease. Halfway home in the final period of play. UMass Boston takes the faceoff. Shantz thought about a wrister. Recovered now by Trine. It's Natasha Storbiak. Hicks trying to clear it. Trapped along the board. Storbiak trying to clear now. Sticked away, and finally trying with a little bit of space to work with. They go off the boards. Shantz keeps it in the neutral zone. Now flips it back. Pass ahead. They caught him in a line change, and oh, McDougal had a breakaway chance there. Couldn't quite keep the puck tight to the stick. Weaving through now, it's Brandy Nelson. Wilson, excuse me. Whistle on the play here came from the far side official, and it's going to be UMass Boston opting for a complete line change. And going now to the sin bin is Katie Wilbert. Second penalty for UMass Boston today. Trine still playing clean. So for the second time, UMass Boston goes on a penalty kill. Once again, the numbers. Trine has 5 power play goals on about a 20% success rate. UMass Boston has allowed 4 on an 86% kill rate. They killed off one earlier and did it handily. Shot comes in immediately on net, and Kennedy covers it up. The earlier power play came with a couple of shots, one of them on net, a decent, albeit not great one for Trine University. UMass Boston had as many decent chances in those 2 minutes. It's going to be a slashing penalty on Wilbert. Kelsey Ryan now, and again, aggressive penalty kill play here from UMass Boston, going for the net themselves. Trine takes it behind the goal. Still, UMass Boston has stayed aggressive with that forecheck as they did on the first penalty kill. Swerving through, Brandy Wilson poked away. UMass can't force it quite into their own zone, in their own offensive zone, rather. Vandenhoevel, Trine's opting for a change here. And you get Grace Canty back on the ice along with Emily Moore. They want their best skaters out there, or at least the ones who have played the best today. But the puck comes all the way down and halfway through the power play. Still no really good chances for Trine. UMass Boston making the breakout hard. Trine is just not connecting the passes they need to. They are not dealing with the pressure in a way that will generate them opportunities. They have had some standouts here in terms of puck handling, in terms of passing, but as a team effort, they've had a hard time staying cohesive, assertive, confident. The pass work has not always been particularly snappy. 30 seconds left in the power play, and only now do they gain their offensive zone. Grace Pandras, 20 seconds on the power play. Puck ejected all the way down. Giving chase is Kelsey Ryan. She gets to it first. 5 seconds to go. And this is how the power play will expire. Katie Wilbert goes to the bench. Coming on is Katie Leffler. UMass Boston back to even strength now. Vandenhoevel, slingshot from the point. Pad save Kennedy. Stick down there. Buddington. Here comes the pass. Gustafson. She'll have Leffler with her. Gets past one defender. Swerving in. Centering pass. Tip. Diving on it is Nettesheim. It took her a minute to realize where it was after the rebound. She gets to it just in time. Don't cut it off before the riff. It's really annoying. Gabby Shantz whiffed on a slingshot from the point here, but it'll send it behind the goal instead. 6.5 minutes to play. Gabby Shantz flips off the boards. Nice pass there, but sticked away by Jade Pandras, who read the play well. 6:16 to play. Again, the forecheck bearing down like a herd. Grace Hicks tips down. Complete line swap here for Trine. They timed it well. UMass Boston's had this shift out for a little while. Rachel Burem now. Corinne Tretchell. Tretchell and Shantz go down for a change. Got some reinforcements out there now, and one of those reinforcements is Jane Ann Drill. Look at the stick handling from Drill. Swerving into the offensive zone, behind the net, behind everything. The speed on Jane Ann Drill. She's earning herself a shot. Tipped away, couldn't get through. Fresh legs injecting some energy. 5:25 to play in the third period, and trying running out of time to mount any kind of comeback or even some momentum here. going to hand Victoria Kennedy a slightly easier clean sheet than she had last week, when she had to stop 42 shots before Elmira got to her in overtime. Centering pass, tip shot just wide of the right post. It was Anna Gustafson. McDougal, pass inside, deflected again through the crease. Centering pass again, and finally Nettesheim covers it up.
Working on a mystery.
Yeah, you could do worse than this song. 4 minutes 53 to play now. UMass Boston looking for another goal, keeping their foot on the gas, maybe just for funsies. Want to keep the momentum going into a game tomorrow, which should be against a team of roughly the same strength. It's a little tough to gauge some of them. UMass Boston's played 7 games coming into today. Trine played 8. But Stevenson has played 6. They're 54th to UMass Boston's 34th in the pairwise rankings. If it's Bowdoin, they've played just 2 games, and they're sitting at 62 out of 71 teams in Division III women's hockey. So tough to say, but one way or the other, UMass Boston, barring a major comeback here, will advance to the championship game tomorrow at 4 p.m. and will be the favorite in that game, you would think. 4:22 to go. Taking it now, Casey Mleko. Gustafson stopped briefly. UMass Boston now. Katie Leffler, she's got a 1-on-4. Gonna swerve behind the net, use some of that speed. Taken down to a knee there. Under 4 minutes, Trine takes back the puck. Swings wide, intercepted by Burum. Burum, shot inside, no good. Burum taps it back, nice little leave there. Someone's lost a stick. It's Emily Moore of Trine. Fires in, shot, deflected wide, almost went in off the glove of Nettesheim. Moore with a stick back. Shot blocked in front, never made it through to the crease. Off the stick of Shantz. Kaylee Kozik now of UMass. Crafty stick handling, swerving behind the net. Centering pass right into the clutches of Casey Mleko and Trine. Gabby Shantz all over the place, keeping this puck on the UMass Boston offensive half. Oh, and a breakout chance now. Teresa DiMaggio swerving in. Tip shot, easy catch there. Every time Trine has had a breakaway opportunity, or what might be a breakaway opportunity, the speed and the decisiveness of the UMass Boston back check has held the Thunder down. Face off in their offensive zone now for the Thunder, and they win it. Point looking for anything. DiMaggio slingshot blocked by Wilbert. Centering pass, thicket of sticks, no dice. DiMaggio recovers. Fires a shot in as she fell down. Almost got it in. Puck skitters away. Katie Wilbert with a dive. Katie Wilbert putting her body on the line in every instance. Annabelle Scriver, tips behind the net. 2:22 to play. Trying some sustained offensive zone time here on a loose puck in the crease, immediately covered up by Kennedy. She has not let those hang around long enough for anyone to do anything about it. Face off now, 2 minutes, 3 seconds to go. Under 2 minutes remaining now. Trying at this point, just looking to get something, looking to not be shut out, really. This is the first time they managed to keep it in their O zone for more than about 30 seconds in this period. with the exception perhaps of the power play. But even on the power play, they were not particularly consistent in their offensive pressure. Puck skidding right around, skate to skate, stick to stick. No one keeping it for very long, and finally Trine keeps it. Oh, and Kaylee Kozik had a breakaway chance there. Her skates got tangled up in Scriver's. She took a hit, and it'll be an offensive zone faceoff for the Beacons. A minute 13 remaining. UMass Boston keeps it in. It's going to be a penalty on Scriver. So UMass Boston going to get their first power play. It's going to last throughout the end of the game. Good time to get a penalty, I suppose, when the game is decided. And you're not even going to have to serve the full 2 minutes in any event. UMass Boston looking for a goal for good measure here. 35 seconds to go. 35 seconds for trying to try to kill off the penalty. Hmm. 20 seconds now. UMass Boston, not a whole lot of urgency on the power play. And as the final seconds tick down, that will do it. A resounding second period of dominance for UMass Boston. 3 goals in the period. Liz Cramp, Kaylee Kozik, Hannah McDougal. And it was never a contest from there on out. Second and third period with dominating defensive pressure and precious few opportunities for the Trine University Thunder. After that, there was really just nothing they could do to break through. UMass Boston set up shop in their offensive zones. The only real disruption to it would be the two UMass Boston penalty kill chances, but even then, not very much by way of good shots for Trine. For UMass Boston, after a tough, tough loss to Elmira their last time out, got an easier opponent and controlled the game after the first intermission. The assists on this one, but we said the goals, Cramp, Kozik, and McDougal. Assists for Kozik, Cramp, Katie Wilbert, and Addie Buddington. We are going to talk to Addie Buddington and to head coach Danielle Blanchard in just a minute. We're going to take a quick break and be right back with their thoughts on this game, on where this team is, and what they need to do heading into tomorrow's game. We'll be right back. Hey guys, here with junior defenseman Addie Buddington after a 3-0 win over Trine University. And just to kick off with, there was a noticeable pickup in your guys' defensive pressure. We saw going into the second period. What was the key for you guys to turn that around?
We usually play very aggressive, trying to pinch on the boards, making sure we have our center back so that we can keep that puck in the zone. Especially with them, it was a little bit tough because they were flying someone high, but we still managed to watch that girl going high and then come down the boards and still play aggressive.
We saw you grab that assist there on the third goal and Hannah's goal. What were you reading on that play and how that developed?
Just quick up the boards, making sure we're getting, you know, back in the zone quick. We don't want to, you know, play around with it in the neutral zone. We want to get up quick. That's what we worked on in practice, is D up to the wings, super quick, getting into the zone and getting those shots on.
And lastly, you guys are going into a game tomorrow. You're not sure who the opponent is. How do you prep for a game like that? How do you make sure you're ready when you don't know until maybe 18 hours before puck drop who you're going to be playing?
You just got to come out how we've been playing. We prepared today. I think we should prepare the same way. All week we had intense practices. No matter what team we're playing, where they're from, what their ranking is, we just got to put our heads down, go, be focused, be ready to go.
Awesome. Thank you so much for your time. Congrats on the win.
Thanks.
We are going to see. The game starts tomorrow at 4 p.m. We're going to take a... I'm going to take you off. You can grab the headset. Thank you very much. We're going to have a chat with head coach Daniel Blanchard in just a couple of minutes. A little bit of the breakdown here. UMass Boston wound up with a massive lead in shots, courtesy largely of that second and third period jump. The first period, much more evenly matched. There's a lot more sticks and passing lanes coming on the Trine side, and the play coming back and forth between each team's offensive zone. The second period, everything changed. UMass Boston coming out far more aggressive. They set up a tent and then a house in their own offensive zone. The forecheck put the screws to the Trine University Thunder, and they had a hard time breaking out. Stats say single-digit shots for Trine in both the second and third periods. This coming after a game UMass Boston played against Elmira a week ago today, where, hey, you're playing the number 5-ranked team in Division 3 in the nation. Odds you're going to hold him to single-digit shots in any given period is not going to happen. They played valiantly nevertheless. Sticks in the passing lanes, deflecting the few rebounds that Victoria Kennedy was allowing, because Victoria Kennedy was not allowing very many. This time around, Kennedy with a much more subdued effort because she didn't need to put out quite as much. We have the final stats here. I'm going to take a quick look at them. Victoria Kennedy, 24 save shutout, her second consecutive shutout. The only goal she gave up in the game against William Smith, the only reason it's not her third straight shutout, was a goal she thinks she probably would want to have back. This is a goal that came on a 1-on-4 from distance. It looked like she had been screened. Just one of those things. But 42 saves, a career high against number 5 ranked Elmira. 24 now against Trine. On the opposite side, Emily Nettesheim. It's hard to scoff at a 943 save percentage. Despite a few errant rebounds, she had a good game. The goals she gave up. First on the redirect, Liz Cramp on the feed from Kozik. Second, Kozik on the feed from Cramp and Burum. Third, Hannah MacDougall on the feed from Addie Buddington, who you just heard from, and then from Liz Cramp as well. Not a whole lot she could do about two of them. The first one, you say maybe she fixes the redirect, but a 943 save percentage is nothing to sneeze at. 50 saves in a game is nothing to sneeze at, no matter how many you let in. And for UMass Boston, they started to shore up. The one deficiency they had was faceoffs, and they took control of it in the second period, made use of it. By the time the margin had swelled back to its original 8-10 faceoffs won in favor of Trine University, the game was just about a foregone conclusion anyway. Now we've got the head coach over here, the victorious head coach. Thank you very much, Allie. And coach, first off, what do you like about the effort coming in off that game against Elmira? It was a tough loss against a very good team. What would you think about the effort coming out of the gate?
Yeah, so we've been stressing compete, compete, compete. And that's exactly what they did. They had a lot of energy. They won some battles. You know, that's what we've been kind of focusing on. And we executed tonight.
It looked like there was a very noticeable change coming out of the first intermission there, where all of a sudden the forecheck's clicking. Trine has immense problems breaking out of their own zone. What was the message there at the first intermission to get the team to that level of defensive focus?
Yeah, I mean, Trine's a new team. We've never seen them before, so we had to make a few, you know, adjustments in-game. But, you know, during the period, we were able to clean some stuff up and then just go to work.
What's it like going into a tournament like this where, I mean, you've never played Trine before, and you don't know now, and we won't know for a few hours, who you guys are going to be playing tomorrow. How do you prep a team for that?
Yeah, I think, you know, it kind of the home ice advantage. You know, the team has never won this tournament, so they have a little extra motivation going into the game, and I think that they just want it. So, you know, the prep comes from within them.
And where do you think the team is in a more holistic sense? I mean, it's William Smith, one-goal win, Elmira sort of one-goal loss in overtime to a very good team, and then now a win like this where, you know, second and third period, wire-to-wire control.
Yeah, I mean, we definitely, you know, have worked on some offense, you know, producing a little bit more. We get our opportunities, but, you know, not quite burying, you know, our shots. And so we're looking, you know, not to be as a perimeter, getting more on the net, finding the rebounds, and just kind of taking care of those loose pucks.
Awesome. Well, Coach, best of luck tomorrow. We will see you then. For now, UMass Boston takes this one.
Thank you.
3-0 over Trine University. Just a quick couple of thank yous before we sign off to Addie Buddington and head coach Blanchard for speaking with us after the game. To Allie Crawford, our director, to Seth Orensky, our producer, and to Aiden McMillan on camera. Once again, the final score, UMass Boston 3-0 over Trine University. They will play the winner of the Bowden-Stevenson game tomorrow at 4 p.m. I will have that game for you here along with our entire Beacons Broadcast Network crew. I'm Milton Posner. Thank you so very much for watching, and have a great rest of your day.